All right. I am live in my green room show with Ralph Humphrey tonight. And it looks like the connection is good. The signal is good. And I'm looking on my Facebook page and everything is good. So I'm feeling happy about that.
Perfect.
Okay. So I just wanted, there's so many things that I can ask you as a drummer. And just before I went live, I was mentioning that as a drummer, I always liked playing drums, but I didn't have the passion to put in the time to work and practice all that stuff. But I watched an interview with you and you had talked about how you started playing drums and you liked it. And you were initially playing clarinet and everything, but you started playing drums. What really gave you the passion to explore that and want to do more of that?
Well, that's a good question. And I was playing clarinet, like you said, from about age 9, playing in, you know, elementary, junior high school and high school, symphonic bands, things like that. But I guess I was also interested in jazz and improvisation. My mother was a pianist and she played the classics in the house. She loved ragtime. She loved Dixieland. And so I was listening to some of that stuff as well. Of course, it always had a clarinet player in the band and a drummer in the band. And so I was checking out both. And one particular person I really started liking a lot was Pete Fountain.
Mm.
And there was a great record called Pete Fountain Day with Jack Sperling on drums. And so as I was learning how to play some of Pete's licks on the clarinet, I was also checking out the drums and really, really enjoying the drums. And I can't quite remember when, but I know that my mother gave me a pair of sticks. I must have asked for them because after listening to Jack and whatnot, I thought I want to maybe tap along with what I'm hearing. And so I used her ironing board. It seemed to have a pretty good response. it was a great substitute for a practice pad. And so I would just play along with some of the stuff I was hearing and not really paying too much attention to, what I was doing. But, interestingly enough, an opportunity came my way where I was playing clarinet in this Dixieland band. High school Dixieland band. We were doing some pizza joint gigs and, you know, things like that. And we had this one job and the drummer didn't show up. His drums showed up, but the drummer did not show up. And so I decided, well, why don't I just sit down and play? And I did. And it was like, I think I know how to do this. So there was enough music in my household, enough music in my school. I was learning a lot about music. I seemed to kind of know what to do. So that was the beginning of drumming. And I guess it was a love right from the beginning.
You know, as you're saying, it made me think that, you know, some of us are born to do something and we know what that is. At some point, it just hits us. We know what that is. And it sounds like you just knew instinctively that's what it is for you and that's what you wanted to do.
Well, perhaps, you know, I mean, I played the clarinet for a number of years through junior college. It was never an instrument that I loved, but I did learn about music playing that instrument. I'd learned about playing with other people. I learned about form in music, how to read, watching a conductor, all that sort of thing. So I think a drummer needs to do all that because the drummer really is the leader in the band. And so I guess when I sat down to play the drums, I knew how to sort of take control over what was going on. I certainly knew the songs in this Dixieland band. So that was not a problem. Technically, I don't know where I was at technically at all. I mean, yeah, I guess I was good enough to get through, but that was the beginning of it right there.
Here's the other thing that made me think about you've been a teacher for 40, 50 years or something crazy in Los Angeles, and almost anybody who has become a really good drummer from Los Angeles has studied with you or knows you. And one of the things that I think some guys, when they start off playing, they just want to play, they want to play, and they don't realize all the things that you just said, what about learning to know music and play music and know the form and everything. If somebody comes to you as a drummer or want to take lessons, what's some of the first stuff you tell them that they need to have as a foundation?
Well, if it's a one-on-one private lesson, I usually treat them a little bit differently than if I was in a classroom where there's kind of a set curriculum that I can follow. But a one-on-one, I'm interested in first of all, seeing where the student is coming from. You know, they're going to have things they want to learn. And so right away, I'm going to ask them, well, what do you want to do? And then I'll ask them to play. And that right away, I'm going to learn a lot just by watching them play a little bit, technically, musically, sound wise, how they move, their motion, all that sort of thing. So I learned a lot. And at that point, I begin to sort of put together a little program for them that I think would be, you know, good for them. And, you know, I make them realize, where I see the problems in their playing. That's why they're coming to see a teacher, first of all. Mm-hmm. So I make them aware of what I see. And then they usually confirm, yeah, you're right. That's exactly one of my problems, you know. So right away we say, okay, let me structure a pathway and let's get going. And it could be anything. It could be a technical adventure. It could be conceptual. It could be, learning how to get a better sound. It could be working on just some holes in their playing that they need to work on. It could be soloing. It could be a lot of different things. So I like to take a one-on-one approach with each of my students. So I don't necessarily have a set course that I would do.
Well, when taking lessons in Redwood City, I studied with Scott Morris for a little while, and he had Don Haas and Larry Grenadier. I don't know if you know either of those guys.
I know Larry Grenadier. He's a great bass player, one of my favorites. Yeah, and I know who you're talking about, the drummer.
Don Haas. Yeah, Scott. And so Scott did this class where he had his drummers sit and play with Don, the keyboard player, and Larry, and then we would trade fours, and they would make us as drummers trade fours, or they would say, take a chorus. And if you got lost, they would say, you don't know the tune. Mm-hmm. And
that's right.
So I just thought of that when you were saying you got to know the form and everything. And so what they would make us do as a drummer in that class is sing the tune in your head while you're playing the song.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that was something that I never, ever thought about many times. And I know some people may do it instinctually. Mm-hmm. Is that something when you started playing that you were doing because you seem to know your way around the songs and everything so well?
Well, maybe it comes from, you know, playing the clarinet and playing really good music in the bands and whatnot that I was doing. And then in the Dixieland band, for example, I mean, every tune has some sort of formal structure. Mm-hmm. And I can't say that I was, you know, totally aware of thinking about the form, but I heard the form and I realized how songs were built. They were built in phrases, usually 2 bars, 4 bars, 8 bars, 12 bars and 16 bars. So, mm-hmm. you know, that sort of hit me as being normal. And so I just heard music that way. And then getting more and more interested in jazz and bebop and whatnot, and listening to, you know, the Great American Songbook by all the great players, you know, it struck me that I was paying attention to form because I needed to know where I was in the song. Mm. And so it was more than just being, you know, playing a beat as a drummer to some sort of music that's going on. You need to really know the form because then you can control the situation. And that's what drummers need to do.
And especially in jazz and big band, drummers really do drive everything and create a lot of the direction of where everything's going. Well, you know, other people do too, but that's really one of the drummer's jobs, right?
Absolutely. You know, I always tell my students, you know, you are the leader in the band, even though you're behind, and it's not the guitar player or the singer who's mm-hmm. leading. You're leading, even though they might think they are. And so that means you need to be the smartest person in the band. You need to be aware of form, how you get from one section to the next, how you transition from section to section. You need to know about dynamics. You need to know about, you know, fills and setups and things like that. And so it's a handful of stuff that you're in charge of. And then of course there's the feel that you're trying to get. You know, it's more than just timekeeping. It's what kind of a feel does the timekeeping have? And so, you know, you've got to go deeper and deeper and deeper. And you do that by investigating other players and learning about feel and the nuances of, you know, is the eighth note straight or is it swung or is it in the cracks?
Right.
You know, because it can be any of those.
And that makes me something really interesting, because you said you were into jazz, and I know you're from watching the interview and reading about you that you came to Los Angeles to play with Don Ellis.
Right.
And I always, and you're mentioning feel. when did you start learning about all the different kind of feels, and who were you looking at to emulate or learn about that stuff in those early days of forming your playing?
So as I got more into drums, I was obviously listening to a lot of different people. You know, Dave Brubeck was interesting right from the very beginning for me. Joe Morello, I loved his playing. I loved his sort of subtle ways that he works his way through some of the odd meters and things like that. Obviously, technically speaking, he was brilliant. And I was sort of picking up on some of that. and then I was also listening to, you know, the more New York style bebop stuff and getting into those drummers as well as big band drummers like Jack Sperling, Mel Lewis, Buddy Rich, obviously, and some of the great session players in LA, you know, on some of the great records that I was listening to. And so I was really starting to investigate feel, sound, style, all those sorts of things. And it was beginning to rub off on me, and I realized, you know, how important that was. And then also playing in the high school big band as a drummer, I learned, you know, how to set up figures better, started to learn more about feels and things like that. Most of it was jazz oriented at the time. So it was, you know, spang, spang, a lang, not too many, you know, rock and roll kind of grooves. That came sort of after I left high school. But I was, you know, of course, I was listening to, you know, pop music as well at the same time as I was listening to bebop. So Elvis Presley and Fats Domino and Little Richard and all those people, the Platters. And, you know, I mean, you know, I was listening to all that stuff as well and checking out those grooves. So I was, you know, and then Cannonball Adderley was a favorite of mine, and I loved his group and everything he did, you know. So, yeah, I did a lot of listening. And I guess a lot of it just started rubbing off, and I wasn't thinking so much about the feel. Well, you know, I guess I was investigating feel, because I would play along with the record. I did a lot of that. And I guess I was trying to emulate the feel that I was hearing, as well as the drum part that I was hearing. So they go hand in hand.
You know, one of the things I'm thinking about in feels, and the most difficult one would be playing in a big band, and somebody says they want to play that Count Basie laid back feel.
Yeah.
Which was something where I hear a lot of guys that would try to do the laid back thing, but the time would drag. So,
well, see, the problem there is that it's not the drummer that's laying back, it's the band that's laying back. Right. And the drummer has to not go with the band, because he will drag. So the drummer in the rhythm section has to keep it moving forward. I always tell my students, the time has to go forward. You know, even though you're trying to like lay it back, so to speak, you know, Mm-hmm. What does that really mean? It doesn't mean playing behind the beat. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a feel. Mm-hmm. That's the difference between, you know, thinking about, well, I got to play slower, you know, or behind the beat. No, that's not what you want to do. It's a feel thing. Mm-hmm. And you're really not playing behind the beat.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it always seems to me when I really listen to drummers, especially in bebop and some of that big band stuff where you're having to move a lot of horns.
Yeah.
That the hi-hat and time is slightly on top of the beat, just sort of pushing it forward.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a guy tell me one time when I was playing something, a lead trumpet player come over to me and really school me on, dude, I've got to hit this high note. You have to be there. You have to, it's up to you to make me play that.
Mm-hmm.
That gives me a whole different concept of what the drummer's role is when you're saying setting up figures and keeping the time.
Right.
And I think that concept of laying back just always never really, I never really understood it. And I think you got to move those horns along.
Yeah. You know, I've really, over the years of teaching and listening and all that, I've gotten some thoughts about timekeeping. And how do you get a laid back feel? The one thing you can't mess with the downbeat. You have to be right on the money with the downbeat. It's the backbeat that can be messed with.
Mm.
So that's where drummers will lay it back ever so slightly on the backbeat, but the front beat, which is the downbeat note, has to be right on the money. You can't be late there.
Mm.
So, you know, you talk about the lead trumpet player, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So conceptually, you know, timekeeping is about tempo and about feel and then playing appropriately the music. So if you're in a big band setting, you got a handful of stuff that you're dealing with. Like you said, the band is big and is heavy. Mm-hmm. It's a big weight.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't let the band pull you back. But if you're trying to get that sort of quote unquote laid back feel, it's the backbeat area that you're going to sort of mess with, not the downbeat notes, the one and the three. Mm-hmm. The two and the four, you got some ways to move there.
That's interesting. I've never heard it explained that way before.
Yeah.
And how much of it, and then as you progress and move forward and you got into the Frank Zappa stuff, which was completely different from what we're talking about.
Right.
How much did who you play with dictate how you're going to play and feel?
That's a good question too. I think, you know, I played a certain way with Don Ellis, but you got to play the music. And so, you know, I couldn't just be myself and think that I can play Don's music. I have to adjust to his music because it has different demands. And then he has demands of me as well. Same with Zappa. I joined the band and I had to sort of make myself join that band so that what I played was appropriate for what the band was playing. So again, it's less of an ego thing and more of a join the band, you know, do what the music is telling you what to play. I tell my students this all the time. Good music will tell you what to play.
Hmm. That makes sense. But I want to ask you, because of historically now, as we look back at what Frank Zappa did and everybody's, oh my God, what did it feel like when you first started with that? Did you have any idea that it was going to be as significant as it's become?
No, I did not. but certainly I think anybody who played with Frank Zappa comes out the other side with some additional credibility.
Mm.
Because the band was, well, Frank, first of all, was such a unique character, and his music was far and beyond the most adventurous music of the 20th century in terms of you know, a band that went on the road and played for teenage audiences. And so I relish the idea of playing this complicated music and trying to make it sound good. Mm-hmm. And the interesting thing is that Frank actually gave me a lot of leeway in regards to drum fills. Yes, he would always have suggestions for me, but a lot of the music was not written out. And so we would rehearse, and he would come in and have some ideas, and he'd start to feed the band these ideas, and he would say, you know, Ruth, you play this, Bruce, you play that, George, you play that, Ralph, it's kind of this groove. So, you know, there was, again, I was trying to make Frank's music sound as good as I possibly could. Mm. And every drummer that played in that band is a different drummer and gives it a different thing. The drummer can change the band so much.
Yeah.
You know, more than anybody else in the band, it's the drummer that really changes the band.
Mm. You know, interesting. I think that sometimes drummers don't really get enough credit from other musicians about how much they actually do drive and change the band.
Maybe it's not said as much as it should, but I think the people that I've played with, I feel their respect for me for what I do. Mm. It's why I'm in their band. Mm. Because I'm giving them something that they need, that the music needs. I'm fully aware of what's going on. I mean, otherwise if I was not interested, I just wouldn't be there. And so, you know, the music attracts me to want to play, you know, that music with those people. Mm. So, you know, and my, you know, I've always sought out challenges, musically. I feel constantly, a need for being challenged with whatever kind of music is out there. So Don Ellis was one challenge and Frank Zappa was another. And then there's somebody like the Manhattan Transfer, a whole other challenge. Or Al Jarreau, a whole other challenge.
And those are other artists that I loved when I was a kid, listening to Manhattan Transfer and Al Jarreau. When somebody would say to me, who would you most like to play drums with? I write out Al Jarreau.
Right.
You know, mainly because of his music and how he sang and everything.
Right.
So how did you move from Frank Zappa and all of that stuff into the sort of pop world then, and into teaching and becoming such a kind of like the staple drummer of Los Angeles?
Well, you know,
Am I describing it accurately? I mean,
no, you are. Absolutely. Yeah. So after leaving Don Ellis, I'm not quite sure what my thought was, like what's next. I think probably it was, well, let's just, you know, stay in LA and start working on a studio career. Because I thought I had the ability to be a good studio musician. I was a good reader, time was good. I'd already played some challenging music with Don. I was beginning to learn other styles of music, particularly R&B and funk, and sort of what jazz sort of became in the 70s. So I was thinking of that, and then, you know, lo and behold, George Duke called me out of the blue and said Frank Zappa's looking for a drummer. And of course it was like the last thing I was thinking of was playing with Frank Zappa. Mm. And so George said, you should come down and audition, because I think you might get the gig. So I did, and I got the gig. So that was that. So, you know, now I'm leaving Frank's band, and now again I'm thinking, well, I think I need to stay in town and get my studio career happening. Right. In the meantime, I was beginning to do some private teaching, because a lot of the drummers who were up and coming were really curious about what I had done with Don Ellis, number one. Mm-hmm. Learning about odd rhythms and odd meters and all that sort of thing. So I was doing some private teaching there and then continued that with after Frank Zappa. But then I thought, okay, let's stay in town and get my recording, my studio career happening. And then lo and behold, I, you know, start getting calls to go on the road with different bands. A few of them I turned down, but the first one I went out with was Seals and Crofts.
Oh,
which is basically a pop gig.
Yeah.
Right. So I felt, you know what, I can do this, because I was beginning to work in the studio, doing some demo sessions and a few, you know, for real sessions, but I had a long way to go. But I thought this would be a good opportunity to work on my pop style, playing with this band, because it was very specific. And Jimmy Seals was a nut for timekeeping. I mean, he really was. And so that was also a good lesson for me, was to really do the job correctly night after night on the road. So I learned a lot just by playing with that. But that wasn't a full-time gig. So I was able to come back to town and you know, continue my studio career. And then later on, 1979, I think it was, maybe 78, a good friend of mine, Jay Graydon, guitar player, who was in Don Ellis's band, started producing along with David Foster. They had a team, and a lot of great things came out of that team, believe me or not. And one of the first things that I did with them was Manhattan Transfer, because Jay was producing them. And so that connected me up with those folks. And so I recorded their record called Extensions. And then thereafter, I went on the road with them for a bit, and then recorded their next record, Vocalese, and then went back on the road with them again. So, and then I went on and off the road with them for a number of years. And that was a whole other kind of, you know, kind of playing, kind of challenge, you know?
I want to just interject something. What I really miss, because when I was a kid and I was buying all those records, I miss pulling out the album and the album cover and reading the credits and Jay Graydon and David Foster and all those, reading where things were recorded and who recorded them. And
yeah,
I really miss all of that stuff about music right now.
Well, me too. And you know, it's when you got that album that just came out that you were just so excited to listen to. Right. It was an experience. You would sit down probably with your friends and you would open the album cover and you would read all the liner notes. You'd check out the personnel, who recorded it, where was it recorded, all that sort of thing, you know, reading the liner notes about by whomever, and then listening to the record and then listening to it again.
Right.
And so for 2 hours, you were immersed in this experience. I call it sit down music. You know, nowadays everybody is standing up in their earbuds and listening to music. You know, it's a whole different time, and they don't have the ability to sit down and check out everything about an LP that we used to do. It was really a great time.
Well, I wanted to ask you about Seals and Crofts, because I was a fan of those guys too. Did you play on any of those records?
I did. There's an album called Taking It Easy. But on the road, I was playing all their hits, you know, the hits that Jeff Porcaro and Ed Green had played on. I was playing all of those. And of course I learned a lot from listening to Jeff Porcaro and listening to Ed Green and all the other great session guys that were playing at that time. You know, Hal Blaine, I mean, my God, he was on so many things, and I learned a lot about listening to him. A lot of other cats that were responsible for hits. John Guerin was a favorite of mine. When I went to LA in 68, he was at the top of my list as my favorite drummer, other than Steve Bohannon, who was playing in Don's band at that time. And so, yeah, the session thing was really appealing to me. I liked records. I liked the drummers on the records. And I wanted to go in that direction.
And so when you started doing the stuff with Jay Graydon and doing Manhattan Transfer, and then when did Al Jarreau and all those things start coming in?
Well, Al Jarreau was next on Jay's list. to produce an album called This Time. And it's one of my favorite Al Jarreau records. Breaking Away is also a favorite of mine. But but now I'm in the company of people like Steve Gadd, Jeff Porcaro, Mike Baird, Ed Green, I felt like I think I made it. You know, I'm actually on recordings with these other phenomenal drummers, you know.
So I'm sorry. It sounds to me like you're kind of like me. Like, I'm such a fan that when I start mentioning the names, I'm going like, is that kind of how you were feeling? You didn't realize that you were actually in that company. You were just more of a fan. Did it feel like that to you a little?
I did realize I was in the company that I thought I could handle. Yeah. I thought I was as good as, you know, those folks, just different. And so it really felt good to me to be on such high quality stuff with high quality musicians who had the utmost of respect by everyone. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, working with Jay, who was a very methodical engineer and producer, down to the details. And I really appreciated that about him, because he would not let anything slide. So if he felt there was something wrong with a take, he would say, let's do that again. And he would point out what he thought was not good enough, you know, and it could be from anybody in the band, but he was looking for that magic take. And I knew that was what I was trying to do as well, was to play that perfect take, not perfect, no mistakes, perfect, the right fills, the right feel, the right, everything's right. The right communication amongst the band. That's where I felt like I had an ability to do what I was doing and be in that company.
Can I ask what is the real difference between playing in the studio and playing live in terms of how you attack? And just for example, there was a time when I did something and somebody said, because of the mic placement, you need to play the hi-hat softer and the snare harder.
Right.
How aware were you of all of that sort of thing? And how did you learn all of that?
That's a good question. You learn that by starting to record and paying attention to those kinds of details. I mean, if an engineer or a producer says something like what you just said, your hi-hat is too loud in the mix that you're sending us. Mm-hmm. They'd rather make the adjustment than do a microphone adjustment. And so I was learning a lot about how to hit the instrument, how to balance myself based on what I was hearing in my headset, and also based on, you know, what I would hear after going into the booth and hearing a take, mm-hmm. and realizing, I need to do that one better, or so I was really checking myself out to see just how I was doing. And in that way, I was able to begin to like fine tune and be able to produce those sort of, you know, one take tracks, which I think every drummer is and every producer is trying to get the drums to have one complete statement. They can overdub everything else. Mm-hmm. Which they did. Mm-hmm. They'd redo the bass. They'd redo the guitar. They'd you know, all those things. But the drum track had to be there. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's why there's so much pressure on the drummer to perform. And so you ask the question, what's the difference between studio and live? I think what happened with me was I learned those things in the studio, and then I took them out when I was playing live. I thought like I was recording when I played live. Mm. And so it would make me bring things in instead of just go crazy and wild and think I can play anything I want. I really learned how to orchestrate and how to arrange by playing in the studio.
How much does editing your playing play a role? Because when I listen to all of the hit records, like all the Al Jarreau, all the, you know, Manhattan Transfer and all those kinds of things, there are not tons of fills, really.
Right.
There's a few that set up something and change from the verse to the chorus, but they're real simple. And when I go live, sometimes you want to hear a lot of stuff, but when I'm listening to a song, I just want to hear the song groove.
Yeah.
Is that what you're talking about a little bit?
Yeah, I think so. I think, you know, the song is the most important thing. And everybody that's playing in the band is supporting the song. So everybody's part has to fit whatever's going on. And so, you know, the drum part, you're always thinking about, you know, if a fill is not required, do not play one. Right? If a setup is required, play one, but keep it simple, you know. So transitions to me are always are the downfall of a lot of drummers. The transitions are rough. You know, the fill maybe is not a good selection of rhythm or not played well or rushing and dragging, those little things, right? Obviously, you know, with a lot of session work, you're playing with a click track, and that presents a whole other thing. A lot of drummers during that time in the 70s did not play to a click track, or they didn't like playing with a click track because it locked them in, right? A lot of drummers felt, hey, it's spoiling my feel. Well, no, it's not. You know, the click is nothing but a guide to tempo, right? You still are in control of the tempo, the time, and the feel. The click is just going along with you, you know, to keep things nice and steady. So that's another thing that a lot of drummers can learn from and learn about themselves is if you practice to a click, you will realize that when you come to a transition, if you end up being ahead of the click, well, you're rushing. And now you hear that, and now you can do something about it, you know. So working with a click in the studio was another lesson that I learned about keeping the time steady, and not allowing the click to control the situation. I'm in control. I'm just playing to the click tempo. That's all I'm doing.
So over the years, then you saw, and because of the longevity of your career, you saw a lot of transition in studio techniques and from no click to tracks. How often did you think about when you were in a studio or even you did some live TV work too?
Yes.
And I want to ask about that because that's a whole nother way of playing.
Yes.
But how often was it put on you, say, hey, we're kind of looking for this kind of feel? And that made you go, okay, well, I'm going to have to play this. I need to, you know, play on top of the snare or play behind the snare. And how often did that sort of happen in the studio with you?
Well, I think, you know, if somebody has a suggestion for me, either the, you know, the singer or whoever's leading or the producer, I'm going to heed their suggestion, and I'm going to think about, you know, what are they really asking me? Because maybe they're not quite sure how to word what they're looking for. So they're trying to explain to me what they're looking for. And so it's my job to figure it out. And, I think a lot of times it might put the drummer on the spot because maybe they don't know what is being asked of them. You know, they're doing what they think is just fine, but somebody's saying, no, that's not quite it. So you've got to figure out, well, what do they mean? You know, and it could be something as subtle as, you know, taking an eighth note feel and slightly swinging it as opposed to playing it straight. You know, that changes the feel drastically, right? And some drummers just can't do that. There was a time when drummers, jazz drummers, could not play a straight eighth note beat. A bossa nova, for example, they couldn't do it. It had this funny swing in it, you know. They couldn't play straight eighth notes. So that's another transition that we've all gone through, you know. Jazz drummers becoming, you know, R&B drummers, and I was, you know, there are many of us that were able to do that, you know, made the transition from bebop and all swing and all that to, you know, eighth notes and 16th notes and you know, learning how to play rock and roll and funk and R&B and all that sort of thing. So yeah, I mean, I'm always trying to figure out, you know, what somebody is asking me to do, and hopefully I'm finding out what it is that they're looking for.
Did one thing that I would remember is when I listened to Elvis Presley records, the drummers back then did that floating between straight and eight.
That was it.
Right?
Yeah.
And they didn't necessarily do it on purpose, but
that's how they played.
It is.
Yeah.
And the thing that I always blew me away is when guys could do it and say, oh, it's Elvis. Okay, I'll play it like that.
Right.
Be able to do it. And that's really hard to do. Are you, those kinds of things are things that you studied and practiced, right?
Yeah. And even though I wasn't paying that much attention to, oh, they're swinging the eighth note, it was a feel. Mm-hmm. And so how do you get that feel? You play that feel, you know, and then you realize, oh, I'm putting a little bit of swing on the eighth note, you know?
Yeah.
And so it, that transition was an interesting one to go through, I think, with the drummers from that period, you know?
Yeah.
I have to say that I feel fortunate to have lived during that time. I think my timing was perfect in terms of how I learned music, how the music was changing, because I was a stone cold bebop drummer listening to all the bebop stuff. And then, you know, and then a big band. So it was jazz when rock and roll came along, you know. I was not a rock and roll player. I was not an R&B player. But I feel that my timing was perfect because I was willing to accept the new style. There were some drummers who did not accept it. Mm. And lo and behold, they were forgotten. They never made the transition. The same thing to me, that same transition happened when electronics came into the game. If you didn't make that transition, well, maybe you're not going to be as busy as you might want to be.
Yeah.
You
know? How did that affect you? Some of that started happening in the 80s.
Right.
How did that affect you and what you had to learn? I also want to make sure that we get into the whole TV show, live TV show thing, and doing Dance with the Stars. And some of, I'm not aware of all the stuff you did, but I'd like to know about that too.
Yeah. Well, I think part of the studio stuff that I was doing was television. Mm. You know, doing episodes of television, and there was a time when I was asked to have put an effect on my something I was playing, an echo. Mm. I needed to put an echo on something I was doing. And they wanted me to do it, not the engineer, because the engineer was recording live. He was recording to two track.
Oh,
that, he was recording the mix. And so everything had to happen with the musicians. So you began to see keyboard players with stacks of instruments and refrigerators filled with, you know, all their instruments. So I had to begin to get into that as well. And that usually was for TV, not for records. Records was still drums, and that's my preferred thing. But in order to continue doing TV work, I had to learn about electronics, and so yeah, that was an interesting another transition that we all had to go through.
Did you know? it almost sounds like you had to become a bit of a sound effect Foley guy almost in a way.
Well, that's what was beginning to happen. Yeah. So, I mean, at some point I had to build an electronic rack with all the things that I would need, you know, mixer and the sound modules and the effects and the whatevers. And it's, but I learned how to do that. And thanks to Yamaha, and I've been with them for a number of years, since 1974. They had the same FM synthesis that the DX7 was based on. They decided to do some drum sounds using FM synthesis. And I was one of the first guys to sort of get into that with them. And so it got me into that whole electronic thing, and I was beginning to learn how to manipulate sounds, create sounds, and then use them for, you know, whatever was being asked of me, you know, on my part, you know. And and you know, and I did a lot of the Star Trek series with the composer Dennis McCarthy, the television show.
Which one? The new Next Generation.
Well, it was going back to, whatever happened right after Spock. I don't know what they were calling it, but it could be Generations. It could have been, but anyhow,
it was a bunch of them. Yeah,
there was a bunch of them. Deep Space Nine, Generations. Anyhow, I did a ton of those, and I was not playing drum set at all. I was playing percussion, timpani, concert bass drum, suspended cymbal, electronics.
Oh.
And so Dennis would put on my part our, he would leave a lot of it up to me. He would give me the tempo, and he'd want an echo on some sort of a device, some sort of a sound, right? He would call it ERS. What? Electronic rhythmic shit.
That's funny.
I know. So I mean, you know, things like that. I mean, it was almost tongue in cheek, but he allowed me to actually decide what kind of sound would be appropriate for this place in the music. But then it was, then, you know, but it had to be there. So I had to make it happen.
So did you create different sounds were you recording any of them, or did you use already pre-made sounds and just added stuff to them?
I had a collection of sounds that I created, and then I would draw upon those sounds for, you know, any of the things that were being asked for me to do. A lot of it would be, you know, low end sort of rumble, you know. He would call it, he had a word for it, and I'm trying to remember what it was. But anyhow, it was, you know, things like that. So yes, I had some go-to sounds, but then once in a while I would actually create something on the fly, you know? And so, you know, these are the things that you learn how to do as a studio musician, not just playing drums, but having to do some other things as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, so you moved and changed as things came up in order to keep working. But it sounds fascinating, though.
Well, it was fascinating. It was, you know, a learning curve. And again, if I wanted to work, I had to make the adjustment. I had to make the shift. And I did. And I'm glad I did, for sure.
And you also did sessions for movies.
Yes, I did.
What were those scores like? Did you play percussion or set?
A lot of times it would be, I'd be called as a drum set player, but I would also be a percussionist as well, a sort of a reserve percussionist. Mm-hmm. If they needed me in the percussion section, I could move over there and play. So I would do any part that they asked me to play. I'm a good snare drummer. I'm a good reader. I can play mallets. I'm not a great mallet player, but I can play mallets, timpani. So thanks to college and playing in the symphony orchestra and symphonic band and whatnot. and studying with Anthony Cerrone, I learned how to do all that. But it wasn't my main job. There were major percussionists that would always be the first call. I would never be a first call percussionist. Mm. But as a drummer, yes. But they knew that I would be able to move over and do the other things as mm-hmm. well.
So during all of this time, this is the, let me just sort of recap from my perspective, the cool career so far. In the most creative time in music for me was like between 68 and 80, you know,
yeah.
Unbelievable. And you were involved in all of that.
Yeah.
And then you're in the 70s, 80s, and you're doing all the electronic stuff. And all this time you're teaching. You started teaching, and you became instrumental in helping a lot of people along in their careers.
Mm-hmm.
And so now you've become the session player. Were you still touring and doing some of those things? I know you toured with Barbra, or you did some stuff with Barbra Streisand.
I worked on a record with Barbra. That was a one shot, one time deal. I never went on the road with Barbra. Mm. That to me, that was a very high profile gig. You know, I'm working with, you know, one of the most incredible singers of all time, and she knows what she wants. And so I was happy to be there, be part of that. And there were some other sessions too that I was very happy to be a part of. Mm-hmm. You mentioned Dancing with the Stars.
Yeah.
And the leader of that band, Harold Wheeler, I had done some jobs with him before. He's very much into arranging, orchestration. He's written a lot for Broadway. And then he had these awards shows. And I was fortunate enough to get a call one time. Probably the regular drummer couldn't make it, and so I was next, and he liked me. And from that point on, I was his number one drummer. And we did 8 years of Dancing with the Stars, which was, again, it was a dream come true. It was like being on staff.
Mm.
If you can get, you know, because that's what musicians used to be, was on staff before my time. This was like being on staff. The same band pretty much every day doing the show. And it was a ball because we were playing live. Live TV.
And there's you don't make mistakes.
You don't make mistakes. You're on the hot seat and you can't blow it. And in 8 years, we never had a train wreck. Not once.
Wow. And did you get some of those things like on the day of, or you always had a chance to rehearse things?
No, we would come in the day of, rehearse with the dancers. This is the first time we've seen the arrangements. We play the arrangement. Everybody in the band was just top notch. So not a problem reading, not a problem doing any of that. So our reading was good. We'd play it down. Rehearse with the dancers, and then that night we'd play the show. So it would all happen in a day. I mean, you know, I love that kind of challenge. I love that kind of pressure. I love it, and it was such a great band.
Yeah, well, you know, it's interesting. All of the situations you've talked about are things that are extremely stressful and a lot of pressure on the drummer.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
And you seem to like the challenge. I, for one, I suck. I mean, no, man, you know, it's one of those guys that, you know, I might be able to make it through it, but man, I just don't, I didn't really thrive under those kinds of conditions. I needed to have a steady gig where I could get comfortable.
I know. And a lot of drummers are like that. You know, they can't handle like that kind of pressure that, you know, you're under. I mean, the leader counts it off. You got to go, you know, and you got to be on it, you know?
Yeah. So did you do any of the awards live shows or any of those kinds of things over the years?
I've done 3 or 4 Oscars. I've done back in the day when they used to do some of the other award shows, I did a lot of those.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, a lot of television shows, award shows and whatnot, because You know, I think I got called because everybody knows I'm a good reader. Mm-hmm. I can play all the styles. I can follow a conductor. You know, I pay attention. I'm on time. I get a good sound. I mean, the list goes on and on and on for what you've got to be a good drummer and a good working drummer.
And you just mentioned all the things that every student, every drummer, or even any musician should just know right off the bat. Be on time, mm-hmm. have your sound together, be able to read, be able to play. I mean, all of those things are so important to when over the years as you were teaching, how many of those things do you always feel like you need to remind your students of?
Well, I remind them all the time. Mm. You know, if I see that they're, you know, they've got what it takes to do what I think, you know, is in pro work, mm-hmm. I'll make sure that they know all of those things and how important they are. You know, sometimes a student might become a little lackadaisical and show up late maybe for a lesson or whatnot, you know, and that can't become a habit because it's gonna show itself one day when you show up late to a gig. Mm-hmm. And believe me, that's something you don't want to do.
Right. Well, in Los Angeles, especially because there are so many people in Los Angeles that can play and want to play.
That's right.
And the one thing that I noticed as I look through all of the photos, there isn't one drummer that I haven't always idolized and admired that I can't find a picture of you with. Especially at the NAMM show, it's like, hey, let's go.
Oh, yeah.
Ralph, you know,
I know. The NAMM show is always a great place to catch up with people you haven't seen in a year.
yeah. Well, so over the year, are you still teaching at Los Angeles College of Music there?
Yes, I am. I am.
Do you still teach at not MI, but
PIT?
Yeah. Where do you teach? Other than
MI was the first place that Joe Porcaro and I taught, 1980 mm-hmm. to 1996. And then we went to what was called then Los Angeles Music Academy. We changed the name to Los Angeles College of Music. Okay. And I've been there since 1996. Yeah.
And you're doing that with Joe?
With Joe. Joe is finally retired. Mm-hmm. Joe turned 90 this year.
Wow.
But he's been my partner ever since. And thank God for Joe. It's been a great ride.
You know, I just, again, and we're at almost at an hour. And I thank you again for being here. But over the years, you know, I just had a birthday yesterday. I turned 62. I wanted to play drums from the time I was 11.
And right.
I showed up at in Los Angeles in 1980. And again, you and Joe, it's like if anybody wanted to learn how to play drums, study with Ralph Humphrey or Joe Porcaro. It's like there's nobody else really from, you know. and I had Walter Rodriguez on.
Yeah.
And he said he owes everything to studying with you.
Oh, man, really?
Yeah.
And that's nice of him to say.
Yeah. What a nice guy. And by the way, I wanted to tell you that Dennis had tuned in and said hi to us.
Dennis McCarthy?
Dennis Moody.
Dennis Moody. Oh, yeah. Because Dennis turned me on to you.
Yeah. And he asked me and he said, would you like to talk with Ralph? I'm like, are you kidding? You know, it's like, come on. There's so many things. You know, we just sort of like touched on highlights. But there's so many things that we could dig into about, especially if we wanted to know about talk about drums. You're right. Doing something on your Facebook page, Rhythmic Awareness.
Yes, I am.
And that can be pretty deep.
Well, my whole thought there was, instead of going to the drums and playing and showing up and showing, I thought, let me just present some things that I've learned over the years. Mm-hmm. That might help people think about rhythm maybe a little bit differently, you know, do some explaining. And I'm putting this out to everybody, you know, lay people as well. You don't have to be a musician to listen to these podcasts because You know, I'm allowing anybody to understand what I'm talking about. But it's also about valuable for any musician and also drummers. And I thought, you know, I haven't seen anything like this before. And I'm thinking, you know, because of the current situation that we're in with the coronavirus and having to go online more now than ever, I wanted to keep myself visible to people out there, you know, because I'm so used to going to the classroom and being one-on-one with my students.
Right.
And so now it's like, okay, I gotta make a shift here. So again, here's another transition. You know, we're being made to transition into something new because the old may be going away. We don't know yet.
We're all learning as musicians, and we talk about this with everybody. What are we going to go turn into now musically to make a living and stay providing music, playing music, and being a part of?
Exactly. Right.
I think, do you do any Zoom lessons?
I've done a few Zoom lessons. I'm preparing to do more. That'll be hopefully in the next 6 months. I will come out with, you know, Ralph Humphrey, you know, online, ready to go. Here we go. Here's what I got. So yeah, that's going to be in the future, because I see where it might become necessary to have an option other than, you know, either on campus learning. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, there's a lot of online learning going on now. Mm-hmm. And I know that a lot of colleges are not going to be on campus in the fall. And ours may be one of them. We don't know yet.
Mm.
So we're taking steps now in earnest to try to adapt to what's going on. Mm-hmm. In fact, we have another meeting tomorrow because we need to record some tracks now because we can't do, you know, the live performance in the class. So mm-hmm. we're going to have tracks for the students. And so again, it's another adjustment.
Right. Do you have a studio?
Do I have a what?
A home studio.
I do not have a home studio. That's probably next on the list. I haven't needed one because I'm usually in LA teaching. And so I've up to this point, I haven't felt it necessary to have a home studio. Now it's suddenly becoming more important.
Yeah. You've got a good experience with all the electronics and studios and everything.
So right.
It would be relatively easy for you to do.
Well, it's just going through the steps. Yeah. You know, now I gotta go through the steps and I will certainly solicit help from all my friends that really know how to record and get a good drum sound and what do I need and all that sort of thing. So yeah, that's gonna be happening.
All right. Well, I don't want to take up too much more of your time, but I just want to thank you. And it's been wonderful talking to you. I mean, I could talk for hours. Yeah. I mean, there's so much that I, you know, would like to get more, dig into a little bit more, but you know, you can only get so far in an hour.
This is true. But you know, in the future, if you want to dig into something a little deeper, we can have a second session.
That would be really fun. And, you know, I do have the ability to take calls and it would be something that, you know, maybe some students or other drummers might want to call up and ask questions of you, something like that.
Right. Well, absolutely.
Okay. Fantastic. Now, I one quick question, though, about this song. And I picked this out because it appealed to me because I grew up in Nebraska and it had that kind of like, you know, country, this Pussy Wiggle Stomp. Well, I mean, I really like that. And I'm going, well, this really isn't big band jazz.
Yeah, that's right.
It's in seven, isn't it?
It's in seven. Yes, that's right.
And I just really kind of fell in love with it. I said, you know, this is perfect for me. You know, all of my friends say, yeah, when we think of Jeff, we think of ding, digga, ding, digga, ding, digga, ding. So, you know, I'm going to close the show with that song again, and thank you for being with me, Ralph, and I really appreciate it.
Well, you're welcome. Thank you for having me. It was a pleasure.
Okay. All right. Again, Ralph Humphrey, and this is Don Ellis, Pussy Wiggle Stomp from 1970 or 70,
yeah.
Right around in there. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ralph.
You're welcome, man.